Hi, I'm Ryan Witte with Holley EFI, here with another Holley EFI how-to video. Today we're going to talk about Holley EFI's integrated traction control, and then if we have some time after, we'll actually talk about how to set up a wheel speed comparison traction control using the I.O. and the advanced tables. To start off, we'll start talking about how our time-based traction control works. To start with, you add a traction control ICF to your tune if you don't already have it. Once you do, select your system type as active speed management. From there, this screen will pop up, and you have to add a few things. The first thing you'll have to add is a speed input so that it knows what to build your traction control curve off of. In this case, there's one set up as driveshaft speed. You can use either a RPM input or a mile per hour input. It will use either, and it will automatically adjust your units depending on which is chosen. From there, you have an option to set up a minimum and a maximum driveshaft speed for activation. These will just set up the bounds for where the traction control will actually activate. So regardless of what you have put in the tables, it will ignore it below this number or above this number. From there, you have your X-axis max time and your timer ignore time. The X-axis just sets up the X-axis of the table. We'll show you that in just a second. And the timer ignore time is just a time-based way to ignore what the traction control would do otherwise, similar to the minimum RPM. So if you know for the first 0.2 of a second in your run that the traction control isn't going to work anyway because of whatever reason your drive shaft curve doesn't look right, you could just put in 0.2 here, and no matter what was in the table for the first 0.2 of the run, it wouldn't use the data. So from there we'll jump into the drive shaft curve. This is where you set everything up. You can see since we had 4.4 in the max time, that becomes the far right of our x-axis. From there you'll have four lines on the table. You'll have what's called, we call the base, retard A, retard B, and rev limit. The base is basically not used for anything. It's actually just to set up a predetermined line based on your logs. So in this case, I've opened up a log of a run in the background. You can see the drive shaft speed here. You can see it actually has some spin. So I'll just take, since that log is open, I can come back here and click import log file, and it will plot the curve for me. And you can see that it exceeded the retard A and retard B line, but did not hit the rev limit line. So we'll discuss how these work using the log now, and then we'll go back to how to set them up. So you can see in this run we have red line is RPM, this lighter red line is driveshaft RPM, and the green line is TPS. So you can see that he was full throttle the entire time. So what you'll see is driveshaft comes up, spun through here, the traction control is able to bring it back in line and allow him to continue the run without ever pedaling the car. So what you'll see is you have your driveshaft rev limit curve, your driveshaft retard A and retard B curve as logged parameters. You can set these up in your inputs and outputs, which I'll show you in a minute. But as you can see, it came up, and right here it crossed the retard A and the retard B line and got into the rev limit. So what that looks like is you look at your driveshaft timing offset, you'll see that it came and pulled 8 degrees out, which was the max. It then, since it proceeded past retard B, started to drop cylinders. You can see this in the driveshaft rev limit. You can see that it dropped 2 cylinders. So the way our system works is when you exceed the retard B line, it will start dropping up to 4 cylinders when you hit the rev limit line. So the first quarter here, it'll drop 1 cylinder. The second quarter, it'll drop 2 cylinders, then 3, and then finally 4. So it's a little hard to see in this one. So I'm going to change the background color. There we go. See, this blue line is how many cylinders it dropped. So you can see as soon as it crosses the threshold, it went immediately to 2 cylinders. And then it dropped back to 1 cylinder as it started to come in line. It got back under control. It started to put a little timing in, as you can see here. And then it lost the tire again and went straight to dropping. It did 1 cylinder, then 2, then back to 1. And then it got back onto the line and under control. So the way that looks in here, as you can see that we have the baseline, which was what he wanted the run to be. And that is the drive shaft RPM here. Then he had his retard A, which was set slightly above it, you can see here. And to tell how far above, you can click the view delta, and it will tell you the RPM difference from the base to whichever curve you have selected, in this case, retard A. So you can see he had it set 150 RPM above his baseline through here, and then down to 100 out here. So after 150 RPM above the base, it would pull timing out. It would step it out. So you come down here to your retard above limit table, and you see that he has it set to pull 2 degrees. And then after 2.35 seconds, it pulls only 1. So in this case, it exceeded the retard A and went straight to retard B, which was set roughly 200 RPM above. So what happens between retard A and retard B is it will continue to ramp timing out. So once you exceed retard A, it steps 2 degrees out immediately, and then it proceeds to retard B. So as drive shaft continues to go between the two lines, retard A and B, as it gets closer to retard B, it will continue to pull the timing out up to 8 degrees. So if your drive shaft curve ends up halfway between retard A and B, in this case you'd end up with about 5 degrees out. From there, if it keeps going as we discussed, the rev limit curve, which was set 1,000 RPM above, will start to pull cylinders out of it. So in this case it pulled 2, as you can see it was about halfway up. To edit the curves, you got a few options. You can drag dots, you can group edit, so you can highlight, then you'll be able to drag multiple dots. You can edit the deltas. You can go back to the actual view and edit the actual RPM. If you want to import a curve and set it to match, you'll take this yellow line that you clicked from import log file. You can right click on it and you can copy it to any of these, or you can offset to any, which allows you to do math on it before you apply it. So in this case, we're just going to build a fake curve off of this. So we'll copy this line to base and pretend it's what we want. From there I'd click it again, and I would offset to retard A, and I'd add 100 RPM to it. So now it is 100 RPM above. Same with retard B. We'll go 200 above. And then we'll also offset the rev limit. We'll go plus 500. So now that we've rescaled everything, the table has automatically brought us into focus. So you can see very quickly now how the lines work and how they've both stacked and scaled appropriately. One thing of note is it will use the time axis you already have up here. So you can see this one's kind of evenly scaled. You may want to do something like this, where you make the majority of the graph very early in the run where you want some resolution. And then we'll re-offset that to rev limit to get it back. There we go. So now we have a lot nicer curve that follows the drive shaft, the imported drive shaft. For the nitrous guys, something important here. Nitrous guys don't want the rev limiter coming on. So what we do to turn off the rev limit feature is you set the curve to 0. So in this case, there is no rev limit. If you exceed retard B, nothing else happens. That's all there is. You could also set it up for part of the curve. Set the deltas here. And go 500. So what you'll see here is up to this point right here, the rev limit's active, and that's 0.68 seconds into the run. What will happen in this case is at 0.68 seconds, the rev limit will shut off. It won't ramp down, it won't do anything, it just flat shuts off at that last point, and then it's zero the rest of the run, it doesn't do anything. You can also zoom in and out on this graph too. So if you want to zoom in and drag the dots closer around, you can do that too. There's also the crankshaft curve, which most people do not use, but it has certain scenarios where it can be quite beneficial. It functions exactly the same as the driveshaft curve, except uses engine RPM instead of a driveshaft or other wheel speed for the activation. This is another log of it working. You can see in this one, wheel speed gets away, traction control turns on right here and drags it back. He pedals it because he felt something wrong after, but he was way too late. The traction control had already caught it. And then out here, it starts to go away again, and it actually snaps the input shaft on the car, and that was the end of that run. But you can see the G meter sags and then comes back. Again, you can see it picked up, dropped four holes in this one, so it shot half the motor off. It actually drug the RPM backwards and the driveshaft RPM down back under control, and then allowed it to keep accelerating after. When he launches the car here, you'll watch the tire make about one rotation and then plant. So right there, and the traction control caught it, brought it under control, and off he goes into the sunset. Until right about there where it snaps the input shaft. So here's another one I did kind of as a giant guess on a friend's pro mod that we were just trying to get down the track and under control. Now you can see the drive shaft comes up, has a little check mark, bounces there, and then shoots up, and we got a little more. And this is one of those deals where we were going into first round, we hadn't made a clean hit, and we kind of took a guess at what we thought the drive shaft curve should be, and the result was this pass. So you can see the drive shaft curve looks a little ugly. We see some stuff in there, but you can see that the drive shaft timing offset, you know, pull a little timing right there, and then a little out here where it probably didn't need to. And then that we also had the rev limit turn on early in the run here. So you can see right here, it calmed it down, maybe didn't need to, but it worked. And then out here, it started coming up, and it actually did bring it under control and allow us to make the rest of the run. This is one of a Ultra Street car using just the timing offset. They do not use the rev limit because they're a nitrous car. And you can see that right through here, you can see the drive shaft curve started to come unsettled and set it back in with the timing. You can see it was enough to really dip the motor down to make it happen. Yeah, they were negative 3.6 degrees of total timing to make that happen. They pulled 14 degrees out. As a side note, when you're getting that extreme with the timing, if you're running a distributor, you need to make sure your rotor phasing is on point and that you don't pull so much that you jump to the next terminal. With coil near plug of any kind, you have a lot more leeway to get extreme with your timing retards for power management in general, whether it be wheelie control, traction control, just timing retard for launch, or any reason, really. All right, so this is the wheel speed traction control and how Doug and I here decided to set it up on his car for a no prep event. Little different than a lot of people do. We think it works better, but I figured I'd share it with everyone to give a try if they wanted. The big thing we did was we created a PWM table for wheel slip. All it is a data table to be put in to be fed into an advanced table of some kind. So what you can see is we just took front wheel speed and rear wheel speed and made them axes on here. And then we made this diagonal here zero, so the scaling's equal on the X and the Y for speed. And then from there, we kind of fudged in the numbers a little bit. I believe there's a little inaccuracy in the math on this one, but someone would have to double check me if they wanted to. But basically, you're just building the wheel slip. You could run the math on each cell and figure out what the exact slip number is if you wanted ultimate accuracy. The important thing is there's interpolation on this table. So if you're running through these zeros, as you get to this corner right here, you're going to have these four cells being used. So it's very important that you not only put the slip percent in, but the inverse on the opposite side so you don't get a false read as you're traveling through cells. So that's why there is this one row of negative numbers offsetting on this side. And you can see we just used duty cycle in this case, rear wheel drive shaft RPM, and basically he's using RPM version of the rear wheel, and then front wheel speed RPM. And then type and frequency don't matter too much, it's just the duty cycle you care about. From there, we just feed it into an advanced table. In this case, he used front wheel speed and then the wheel slip percent to build a table of how he wanted to pull timing. So this is real nice because you just need the one table. So you just take your wheel slip percent, whatever's output from that PWM table, and then by your undriven wheel speed, and you can build a nice table to be more aggressive or less aggressive based on speed and the slip percent. So you can see at low speeds here, he didn't rely on it as heavily as he did at higher wheel speeds. So basically, as he got further down track, he wanted it to pull timing sooner. And how that looks in the log is like this. So we've got rear wheel speed here. We've got his slip percent, which gets kind of high there, probably because he's in wheelie, which is why he had the time delay to start at 2.5 seconds from launch. So it doesn't activate till out here. Interestingly, in this one, he actually used the time-based traction control for the first part of the run. So you can see where it was active through there, trying to keep it on a curve. And he actually shuts it off at around that 2.5 and switches over to the wheel speed. So in this case, you can see wheel speed's good. It has a little slip here. Here's the slip percent. So you can see the drive shaft-based, time-based curve was working through here, keeping him under control. And out here after 2.5 seconds, you can see it started to get out of control here. We had about 3 to 4% slip. And if you look at his wheel speed table, it actually was pulling 10, 12 degrees to try to keep that under control. It was actually tickling it all the way back here, trying to keep the tire under control. And then once it gets through this area, it settles in and has no slip. Well, negative slip, so it doesn't activate the traction control. But that is how I would do wheel speed based traction control.